Hey, what's up, everybody? How you doing? Welcome to Wealth Champs Podcast. I'm your host, Julius Hammond, and I'm here to bring you some fire content throughout these next weeks, months, and years to come. The reason why I started my podcast is because there's a lot of podcasters out there that do a lot, that bring a lot of value and do a lot of things, but there's not a lot that tell their story, that bring on guests that tell their story and be able to add value to you to let you know that, hey, you can go from where you came from or where you're at right now to where God is destined for you to be. But a little bit about myself. Again, my name is Julius Hammond. I'm a father. I'm a husband. I'm a follower of Jesus Christ, Elohim, Yahweh. And I just love everything that it has to do with, just people. I just love people. And my story is pretty unique. I have a book that I've written. I'm also an author. My book is called Die Empty While Living a Full Life. It's about, you know, my journey growing up, how I've overcome family deaths. I've overcome, sicknesses and homelessness to where I'm thriving and surviving and thriving today in the world that we live in. So if I can do it, you can do it too. So that's the reason why I started my podcast, is about having overall general wealth. We're not talking about just finances. We're talking about spiritual. We're talking about having wealth mentally, you know, as far as reading books and renewing your mind daily. We're talking about physical health. We're talking about financial health. And we're talking about building long-lasting, cultivating relationships with key people. That's how you gain wealth in this whole general aspect of it, okay? So today we have what I consider a mentor of mine. His name is Carlos Siqueira. Excuse me if I say his last name wrong. He'll correct me on that, but I always say his name wrong. But Carlos is a father. He's a motivational speaker. He's a businessman. He's a multi-millionaire. And he brings a lot of passion. He's compassionate about people. And he just loves people. He loves helping people. And that's why I look up to him from a distance, and I love him greatly, dearly. He has a book called Work Like an Immigrant. And before we get started, I also want to thank my team for putting all this together. We got my team, videographers, Trainee Films. We have our podcast studio here. It's in Ontario. It's called Ontario Podcast Studio. You can go on our website at OntarioPodcastStudio.com. If you have a podcast or anything that you want to record, you can book your time there. And you know, we can accommodate. You can bring your own props or anything that you need to do, and we have some stuff here for you as well. So just want to make sure I get that plug out there for you guys. And we're just here to help, man. At the end of the day, it's all about bringing value to you and adding value to your life. So like I said, my first guest, Carlos Siqueira, I want to thank you for coming on board. So Carlos, are you there?
What's happening, brother?
How you doing, Carlos? How you doing, brother?
You did bust my name this time. It's Siqueira. I like the
Siqueira. Okay. See, I knew I was going to mess it up, man. I'm sorry about that, man. But I was trying to figure out how to say your name. But you know what? It's all good. It's Carlos Siqueira, right?
Yes, sir, man. I'm super excited to be here, my friend. How you doing?
I'm doing fantastic, brother, man. Thank you, and welcome to Wealth Champs Podcast, brother. Appreciate you, man.
No, man, it's my honor to be here, my friend. As you know, I love serving people. And at the end of the day, man, we come to this world without nothing, and we leave without nothing.
There you go.
You know what I mean? All we're going to take is our character to wherever we are going. Because I joke often, a lot of my friends, you know, they're very wealthy. They've been doing like YouTube and social media for decades. And I always tell them, nobody's going to talk about the Ferraris and the Lambos and the airplanes. They're going to talk about how you made them feel.
There you go.
When nobody was watching, when the phone wasn't on you, right? When the cameras were off, when there was no makeup, and it was behind closed doors, because you can never judge anybody. You don't know somebody's struggle. You don't know what they are going through. You don't know why they are upset or angry. You know, it's like, it's perspective, man. I mean, you know a little bit of my story, and I share a little bit here on your show today. But it comes all down to one thing, my friend. It's literally never forget where you come from.
There you go.
The places, you know what I mean? The values, the people. They were the ones that made you become who you are. You know what I mean? They mm-hmm. are the ones that, like, I was at, in LA this past weekend, was the Nickelodeon Awards, the Oscars, the gala event. And I get invited to a lot of these events. And, you know, they want to interview me and things like that. And I tell them, it's not me. Praise the Lord. I'm just a vessel that God comes just through me. And I speak life into others when they need to hear it.
Yeah.
And I'm just been blessed to beat the odds and survive the streets. And I made a few promises to my friends that were murdered. And I plan on keeping on this promise. Mm-hmm.
Wow. That's awesome, man. And I, like I said, I've read your book, Work Like an Immigrant. And your story is phenomenal, brother, phenomenal. And I just have a few questions for you, man, just for our listening audience and subscribers. First question is, what made you and your mom migrate from Brazil to the United States as a teenager? That story right there, when I read that in chapter 1 and 2, I was like, wow, that's amazing. But what made you and your mom migrate from Brazil to the United States as a teenager?
It's like the struggles, right? I mean, we've seen so much struggles, bro, like growing up in Brazil. And my mom, though, if I would stay in Brazil, I would probably would end up dying, mm-hmm. would end up, you know, becoming a criminal and dying. And it's like we come from a lot of poverty. And then, you know, for some of you guys, I'll tell you guys a little bit about my story. Imagine your father dying in a car explosion and you were a baby. Mm-hmm. And then imagine your stepfather being murdered.
Wow.
And then imagine you have to sell bread on the street when you are age 7, mm-hmm. just to help your mom and pay the bills. And then you imagine being abused and tortured and bullied and going through a lot of the things that some of you guys probably went through as a child, as a teenager. Mm-hmm. So that's what my world as a kid, right? It's always saw was poverty, was abuse, it was killing, it was murder. You turn on the news, it was negativity, it was corruption. Mm-hmm. And that was my life growing up. And, you know, it got to a point where I didn't even want it to be here anymore when I was a little kid.
Wow.
I was literally going to step. So I talk about that story when I speak at some mega event. I try to challenge the challengers to remind themselves it's not about the money or the fame. It's about helping others, because there are a whole lot of darkness out there. But as long as you focus on the light, you will overcome it.
Wow.
And, you know, I mean, like I always joke and I tell people, if you're going through hell, instead of being burned or going back, might as well keep walking. And my mom and I, you know, some of our cousins, they were here working like with painting and landscape and construction. My mom was like, you know, instead of us being here, and you know, she knew it. She was going to lose me. I was going to die. And it was the greatest thing we ever chose to do was just, let's go to America. Mm-hmm. Let's fly in as immigrants, as tourists. Let's let the visa expire and never come back, you know. Wow. And we came. I mean, we came. Thank God that I have to fly through a river. Some of my friends did, mm-hmm. you know, and cross the border dangerously. And I mean, you know, I always tell people, man, when it's our time, it's our time. I'm a firm believer that if something doesn't kill us, it makes us stronger.
Yes.
And I think everything I face in my life, you know, it helps me, you know, like stay grounded and inspire others, right? Mm-hmm. Whether it's that kid in the favelas of Rio, or is that Silicon Valley CEO, or is that celebrity that have 10 million followers that calls me at midnight with a pistol in their hands about to shoot themselves. Mm-hmm. And I tell them, if you do that, you're going to make it acceptable for your followers to do that every time they face something difficult. Mm-hmm. And I joke with them and I say, don't you make me call my mama. They call my mother a viuva, the black widow.
Wow.
I say, you don't make me my mama. I call my mama. She's been through hell, my friend.
Wow.
I tell them, she's been through hell. And I told them, what are you going through? It's not a problem. It's not a bad day. Like my good friend and mentor and professor Les Brown says, it's a character building day.
There you go.
You know? And, you know, I mean, so it's like, it's always another side. And that's my message, man. It's like, and it's funny, you may just make me go back in time and think about those things. Because I know a lot of you right now listening to us, you may be struggling. You may don't have the tools, or you may don't know what to do mm-hmm. to make money so that you can listen to people like him and myself. They often teach people about marketing, about making money, about mm-hmm. investing, about wealth. And all, but some of you may don't have it. And you might be questioning, how do you even make the money so I can invest it? And I'd be happy to share couple of things as well with you guys and give you guys some ideas and perspectives that you guys can start doing today with no money required at all, what you can start generating couple of hundred, if not even a couple of thousand a week, just by, you know, putting yourself out there.
Yes, that's amazing, man. I'm a firm listener. When I was going through the stuff I was going through, being homeless and things like that, and even starting off as an entrepreneur, as an early entrepreneur, I listen to people like Les Brown, Jim Rohn. I know who you know who that is. God rest his soul. Rest in peace, Jim Rohn. Brian Tracy, Zig Ziglar. I mean, some of the older motivational speakers and motivators. I was listening to a lot of them, and they just kept me going. Like, I know Les Brown, if I mean, you know, hopefully I get to interview him later on down the line, but that would be awesome because he's someone who I really look up to. However, when I was going through the stuff I was going through, when I was listening to him, I mean, I know his story back and forth. I mean, from the beginning to the end. I listened to his story so many times, and it's literally, you know, when you're down, it's not the fact that it's forever. It's like pain is temporary. Yeah, people don't even understand that. The enemy makes it feels like it's going to be a permanent thing because that's the feeling, you know. But it will subside if you always just keep going, never give up. And pain is temporary, but pleasure can last forever if as long as you continue to thrive and strive towards your goals and your dreams. And like you said, Les Brown said it the best. You have a character building day. You know what I mean? It's building your character up. It's building the person who you are supposed to be up, not this person that you see right now. So if you're down right now, if you're going through things, that's fine. We all go through it. That's just life, okay? It's something you just have to go through. But don't let life get you down and keep you down. That's the key. Second question I have for you. In your book, Work Like an Immigrant, you talk about your grandfather and how he used to discipline you in a form of, you know, beatings or when you were a kid or whatever the case may be. Can you go into detail about that as far as him being extremely hard on you as a kid and why he did what he did as a kid? I know when I was listening to the audible of your book, in my head I was like, man, this grandfather sound really, really messed up. But then when you start really talking about why he did what he did, it made sense. Can you elaborate on that for us, on that story for us a little bit?
Yes, man. So my grandfather, he was like my dad. He didn't have a father. And, you know, he was tough. You know what I mean? Like military background, policeman background. And the biggest thing that you see in life, you got to treat others how you treat your grandma. There is no such a thing as left or right.
Mm-hmm.
It's only one way, and it's straight. It's coming from a place of integrity,
mm-hmm.
and never, ever deviate from integrity.
Mm-hmm.
Never, ever go to the right or to the left. Just stay. Like, it's only one way. And every time that we would screw up as a kid or teenagers, you can imagine, I was selling bread on the street. I was playing soccer with criminals, right? A bunch of gangsters. As I was a little kid. But I'm 6'5", 300 pounds. So I always appear to be bigger. And, you know, sometimes you hang around the wrong crowd. And you heard the saying, you hang around the barbershop long enough, eventually you're going to get a haircut, right?
There you
Somebody's
go.
Stolen the fucking Bible, right?
Yes.
And, you know, I hang out as a kid with a lot of people because I would ask questions. How did you, you know, I would literally go to the butcher and I would say, how would you become the best butcher in town? I would go to gangsters. Why you were a criminal? Why you rob people? Why you kill people? Because I was in the streets. I was with them. And I would ask questions on both sides. And I would do stupid stuff sometimes. We all done stupid stuff as kids. And then, you know, my grandpa, when he figured, found out,
mm-hmm.
you know, come home, you know, and then he used the belt. He would use extreme measures. You guys know the corn that you feed the chicks?
Mm-hmm.
The hard one.
Mm-hmm.
You put that in the backyard. It's 110 degrees. I grew up in the Amazon in Brazil, extremely hot with warm weather. So you put me on the backyard on my knees. But before I got on my knees on the dirt, you put a bunch of corn that you feed the chick, which is extremely hard. Now I got to be there on my knees for an hour.
Wow.
To reflect. And as I am reflecting, he's mentoring me and he's telling me, in prison is worse. That's his. I was gonna translate here into Portuguese. I have this shit in my head. Na prisão é pior.
Mm-hmm.
Right? In prison is worse. É melhor que você aprenda em casa do que aprenda nas ruas.
Mm.
These words is embedded in my subconscious mind. That means it's better that you learn at home, because in the streets is worse.
Yes.
Right. So he constantly instills those values in me and those things in me to like, don't deviate away from your goals, right? I got it. You got to work. You sell your bread. The little time that you have, you study. I don't care if, you know, you study at night if you cannot study in the day, right? In third world countries, in many countries, they have school like at nighttime mm-hmm. for like adults and kids that cannot go to school because in a lot of countries, kids and young kids, they work to help their parents. Mm-hmm. So, you know, my grandfather always wanted me to stay out of it, out of trouble, because he knew the odds were against me. I have all this hate and all this anger that were building inside me as a kid mm-hmm. from all the wrongdoing to my family. And, you know, I always tell people an eye for an eye only does one thing, and that's make the entire world blind. Mm-hmm. And, you know what I mean? So it's powerful things that I never like violence, because violence only brings more violence. Mm-hmm. But I understand why he did that. I understand why he did that, to embed that in my mind, in my soul, in my nervous system, that whatever you do, always operate from integrity, even if that means getting a beating, right? Mm-hmm. And when you think about that in our own lives, when you go into something difficult, if you screwed up, if you messed up, face it, talk about it. Mm-hmm. You did something wrong, talk about it. Whether it's your business partner, your spouse, yeah, am I leading to an argument? Am I leading to something? But it's better that you face it and you talk about it, you face your demons. Mm-hmm. Because whatever you do, when you do it, you're gonna now remove those layers and you're gonna get out of your system, right? Mm-hmm. What you resist will persist. So if you are resisting all the wrongdoing, all the rejection, all the people that let you down, the people that we call that didn't answer back, you know, all those things and all the businesses that you have pride that you failed. And sometimes we have this thing that we call conscious blaming, mm-hmm. right? We tend to blame it on others. But the best thing that you can ever do is just look yourself in the mirror. We are our worst enemy. Mm-hmm. You are the only person that is on the way for yourself to become with whatever the wildest dream that you want to achieve. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So, yeah, man, you brought me back in time over here, my friend. Those knee... I always joke with my daughter, you're lucky. You're lucky. Scooby, Scoob, you know? The kids nowadays, right? You know, you'll be around my grandpa. But yeah, my brother, a lot of lessons from that beating. I always talk about there is always blessing in darkness. Mm-hmm. Because in those dark times that it sucked, it was hot, it was hurting, my back hurt, my knee hurt. But I reflect. And that reflection is embedded in your nervous system. Mm-hmm. To always put people first. Mm-hmm. It's all about helping others, it's about putting others first. About operating from integrity, because if you treat others how you treat your grandma, I don't care what you do, you're always going to have a place to sleep. You're always going to have clients. Mm-hmm. You're always going to have, if you are an influencer, people going to invite you to speak on their shows, on their stages, at the Oscars event, at this place, at that place. Mm-hmm. Things that I did not even encompass as a kid, selling bread on the streets, knowing that one day I was going to be speaking at the Oscars, riding down on a pink bicycle with a sombrero, throwing wow. bread at the left. Do you know what I mean? Like,
yes.
Stuff like that. Like, when I was a kid, you know, I knew it. I always talk about it. I was going to inspire and mentor celebrities and presidents and athletes. Mm-hmm. I always say that to myself, because in my mind, in my kid, younger self mind was, if I can get to them, I can impact hundreds of millions of people, mm-hmm. if not a billion plus people, in my short life here on this planet. Mm-hmm. You know, and whatever you talk about, you become. And thank God I used to talk about this thing for a very long time as a child. People always look at you, oh, you're going to die in the hood, kid. Mm-hmm. You dream too much, talk too much. You don't belong on this side of town. And I always tell people, it's not what you come from, mm-hmm. but the color of our skin mm-hmm. is that our attitude that's going to make us win. You know what I mean? It's something I always tell people around the world, that to never judge somebody just because they come from another, from the favelas or from the blog or from the hood. You know what I mean? Because we are all equal. 150 years from now, none of us are going to be here.
There you go. And that's awesome, man. You know, the crazy part about it, when you were saying that, it had me going back into my younger days and some of the stuff that I've been through. And I remember I was in school one time. I think this happened when I was in junior high school. I actually had a teacher. I was one grade. This is crazy. I was supposed to get a C in the class, but I ended up getting a D. And because I got a D, I didn't get to walk the stage, right? But she told me, she said, Mr. Hammond, you're not, she pulled me to the side, and she said, you know, I'm giving you a D. And it's the best thing that she did for me. At the time, I didn't realize it, but it's what she told me that really struck a nerve with me. She said, you're not gonna really pan out to be anything. You know what I mean? Like, she said it, she didn't say it exactly like that, but she kind of put innuendos in there and kind of, you know, you can kind of figure out what she's trying to say. And I'm like, wow, like, really? Like, you really would tell a, and I'm what, 14, 15 at the time, something like that? I don't know, or 13, whatever it is in junior high school. I'm like, you tell me that at junior high school? I'm like, man, I ain't even start my life yet. No, not even near, you know? But that's the type of attitude that and mindset that we deal with certain people, you know what I mean? Because she probably felt that all she is going to be is a school teacher. And I'm not downing school teachers. We need them, you know, don't get me wrong. But I would caution, if you're a school teacher or whatever, or you're an educator of some sort, to always lean in towards your kids and make sure you let them know, give them positivity, because you don't know how impactful your words are to that individual. You know, it says in the Bible, the life and death is in the power of a tongue. You know what I mean? So what we speak out loud as surely is what we're going to manifest. You know what I mean? So always speak life, always speak positivity, always speak, you know, good intentions into people, because that's the outcome that they would ultimately end up receiving in the end. That's awesome, man. Real quick on that story with your grandfather, it was one little thing in there that I wanted to ask you this. Well, I was like, I'm gonna wait till you get on camera and ask you this. It was a part where you went to go. You was a collector, and you know what I'm talking about. You were a collector. You were a collector, and you went to go grab a bat. Okay. And you figure, I guess this guy owed your grandfather some money off of a loan or something like that, pretty much on credit, and he hadn't been paying it back. And so you went to go grab the bat, you went to the man's establishment, okay, with the bat, and then I'll let you take over from there. What happened from there, my brother? I know what happened, but I want you to tell it.
So my uncles, right, yeah, they have, they deal with meat, right? They sell meat to the butcher.
Yeah.
So the butcher didn't pay back my uncle. So, you know, I was big, you know. So when I was seven, I looked like I was 11. When I was 11, 12, and 13, I looked like I was 16, 17.
Okay.
So I was a big kid. And my uncles knew I knew how to fight. I knew how to defend myself and stuff. So my uncles would be like, all right. So my mother hated that stuff, right? But and then I was like, Mom, we got to make some money. And I would get a portion of whatever I collect.
Mm-hmm.
So then I go to the butcher first time. All right, Mr. Butcher. The butcher said, all right, kid, I don't have the money yet. Come back next week.
Okay.
I said, man, my uncle's going to be pissed. Like, I don't care what your uncle's going to think. I'm like, all right, go back and tell my uncle. And my uncle goes, what the heck? So then I get yelled. I was like, well, that's messed up. Mm-hmm. And my uncle goes, go back there. Don't wait 4 weeks. Go back there and talk to the guy. And then I went back there the second time. Same old story. Get out of here, kid. I don't have the money again. I'm like, what the heck? I mean, you sell the meat every day. People come over here, they buy their little ground meat, their little mm-hmm. piece of meat and pork, whatever, right? What the heck? Just pay something.
Yeah.
And then he's like, no, get out of here. And I was like, you see, we are busy, they're clients. And I was like, all right. And then I go back, tell my uncle, and my uncle's like, what the heck? You are the collector.
Yes.
Go over there and grab, do whatever you gotta do. And then he's like, do whatever you gotta do. I'm like, what do you want me to do? Shoot the guy? And then I'm like, you shoot that person, they're gonna pay you. And you know me, I don't like violence.
Yeah.
You know, to cut the umbilical cord away from violence, as I have lost plenty of people. You know, so now, I'm like, okay, I'm going to bring a bat. I figured I'll bring a bat. I was going to intimidate him. He's seen that, okay, now I'm getting pissed. So now I bring a bat. And then I walk in there, right, super confident. And the butcher looks at me, and he puts his little thing in there.
Wow.
And he looks at me like with that face, and then he puts his head underneath and he grabs a shotgun.
Oh, man.
And I was like, oh, shit. And then I never forget it. He's like, never, ever, ever, kid, bring a bat to a battle. Fight.
Yeah. I was like,
and
wow.
I was like, he said, you get out of here. Wow. Tell your uncle next week I'll have the money. I was like, mother, son of a gun. And I was like, okay, put the bed down. I dropped that bed real fast. ain't no dropping the mic or that shit.
Exactly. I dropped that back. Like, I'm out of here.
I'm out of here, bro. And yeah, man, you know, I mean, it's crazy because sometimes, you know, we tend to do things on impulse. And we see, I talk often about this when I'm teaching wealth. Mm-hmm. And the system has been dumbing us down for so long, right?
Yes.
And we are trained to react and not self-reflect.
Exactly.
So when you react, we do stupid stuff like this. I almost mm-hmm. got shot over some meat.
Exactly.
You know what I mean?
Exactly.
So it'll be, it's like, there's a show, I think it's the stupidest ways of dying it. That would suck to go down like that. You know, but thank God it wasn't my time. But it goes all back to self-reflection. A book that I love is I'm good friends to the Napoleon Hill Foundation.
Mm-hmm.
One of my good friends, Sharon Lecter.
I love Sharon Lecter. I love her. Yeah.
She's an incredible, very good friend of mine. We're very close. We share stages over this past decade together and in many events. And Sharon was invited to annotate it and edit it, Out with the Devil, mm-hmm. which is a book that Napoleon Hill wrote back in the day, but they never wanted to release mm-hmm. because of, you know, the implications that it could have.
Mm-hmm.
And that's an incredible book that I highly recommend people reading, which is Napoleon Hill interviewing the devil and extracting the devil's best secret.
Mm-hmm.
And it's very powerful. I'm not going to talk about it like the book, but it goes back to self-reflecting and really thinking about the ways how the media, the government, they program people
mm-hmm.
so that you can cut yourself away from that system where you start self-reflecting, where you start acting like the system instead of being part of the system,
where you
become the thing. Like I tell people, you don't want to be a chess player, you want to become the board.
There you go.
You don't want to be in the system, you want to become the system.
Mm-hmm.
You don't want to be, you know, put your money in the bank, you want to become the bank.
Mm.
You don't want to gamble in the casino, you want to become the
house. Yeah.
Right? So we often talk about those things in Silicon Valley. I travel a lot between Dubai and Palo Alto and San Francisco, Brazil, Mexico. I go to a lot of places and I educate. I teach people a lot of powerful things to leverage AI, leverage technology. Do what the elite is doing mm. and not what they are telling you to do. Mm. Right? But again, it goes all back to self-reflecting, researching, trust nobody, question everything,
mm-hmm.
right? You're always going to be your most inspirational person. You're always going to be your best fiduciary agent. You're always going to be your best enemy, your best mentor. You are the only person on the way from greatness. Only you, nobody else.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I always tell people, because nowadays it's so easy to make money. You can literally, I'm writing this powerful blog post that I'm about to release,
mm-hmm.
and I'm going to put on my LinkedIn. And you can literally leverage AI tools right now to make $1,000 a week. You can get an AI tool, let's say Jasper mm-hmm. is a copywriting AI tool that you can open up a copywriting agency
mm-hmm.
to sell copy, help people write email sequences and blogs and blog posts and social media posts, where you can charge businesses. Let's say you find 10 businesses in your local city, and you tell them, I'm going to charge you $100 a week, and I'm going to write blog posts and post, and I'm going to post it on your social media to keep your clients engaged. So whenever you have a promotion, something going on, we can drive more traffic into your business.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to start at $100 a week, and if I increase your profit, we will double to grow. Is that fair?
Mm-hmm.
So what do you think that business owner is going to say? He doesn't have the time to write the blog, most of them are not writers.
Mm-hmm.
So he doesn't have the time to write the blog post, to do the post every day on social media, and to write the email sequences or to write an email promotion with a coupon for your dry cleaner, or a coupon, buy two tacos, get a taco for free,
mm-hmm.
or buy one pizza, get chicken wrap up, right? So you can be that person that can assist 10 local businesses within a mile from you. If you don't have a car, you can walk there. You talk to 10 of them and you offer $100 to start. If I bring you more profits, you're going to double to 200.
Mm-hmm.
So now you're making 2,000 a week instead of 1,000 a week.
Mm-hmm.
And then you're going to take this AI tool, and the AI tool, you type, you write as much as you know about that business. And what do you want the AI to write about?
Mm-hmm.
You go over there, okay, AI, I want you to write about the pizza establishment, you know, let's say John and John's pizza shop, been here for 30 plus years, family owned, and we have a promotion where you buy a pizza to get the wings for free, and blah, blah, blah. So you type that in the AI. The AI is going to generate a blog to an email that you can now give. You can now give to that person, and you go and email the entire email list from that business.
Yeah.
You tell a story. At the end of the story, you have a promo for them to come back and buy more pizza or buy this new recipe or whatever they got going on.
Mm-hmm.
So now, what do you think is going to happen? The people, they're going to see that, the email, they will see the text, the, whatever automation that business has, and then more people are going to come to that business. Now that business is going to generate more revenue, and you save the day without making a crazy offer. Exactly. All you did, you came to them and said, let me write your blog posts and your emails for $100 a week. If I make you more money, you double to 200. If I don't make you any more money, you don't have to keep me on the payroll. So what I just described there, anybody can do it because it doesn't cost you any money to do that. You know, I mean, you might pay Jasper 20, 30 bucks a month, 40 if you have the upgraded version, but you making $1,000 a week working from home, where it takes you like, what, 2 hours to do this?
Exactly.
Working 2 hours a day to make it $1,000. So you see, money is mindset, guys.
Exactly.
So now that you're making this money, $1,000 a week, you come and see him and you come and see me, now we can show you how to take that money to go make you more money.
Monetize
because
it,
I also use AI and blockchain technology and financial technology, stocks, forex, multiple sectors that I can tell, okay, AI, build me a bot that I can beat the most genius traders in the planet. Now I can have the AI trading on my behalf so I don't have to spend all day on the computer. So that $1,000 a week that you are, now you give that to the AI, to the bot, to go make you on your money. So now you're making $2,000-$3,000 a week. So now that I make you all this money, what is next? What are you going to do, right? So money is mindset, my friend. It's how you look at it. People, we tend to make shit complicated. I wish somebody would come to the block 30 plus years ago and it would told my younger self that, you know, I wish we would have these tools back then, right?
Yeah,
you know what I mean? I would be a billionaire by now. You know what I mean? And we'll get there eventually, but my goal is to be there and donate it all, you know, because at the end of the day, we're not going to take nothing. Our cars, our planes, our islands, whatever we own, we ain't taking shit.
We ain't taking nothing.
What we're going to take is our character.
Yeah.
And that's why I tell people, if you're going through something difficult, listen to podcasts like Hammond is doing over here. Like, listen to my podcast. Listen to people's podcasts. They are giving you value. They're giving you unique ways to make money without asking nothing in return.
Exactly.
Because when you do that, they're going to come back and you don't have to ask for nothing because you're constantly operating from a place of value. What I just told you here now, people fly me in, they pay me 50, 100 grand to go speak at private events just to talk about what I just described.
Exactly.
But again, it's like, you know, it's something so simple, right? It's like you leverage, the trend is your friend. What is the trend in? AI, blockchain, metaverse, all those things are trending. And if the trend is your friend, and if you follow the trend and you watch the most wealthiest people on the planet, where they are putting their money, that gives you hints. It makes you think, like, okay, I see that the billionaires and the trillionaires are putting money into this sector. Let me put a few dollars in there. Whatever level you want, let me put a few hundred in there, right? And then, can you do what you are doing it? And now let your money grow. Diversify within multiple sectors. Not only for advice, but you never want to put everything in one basket. And then as you start helping others, you learn this advice here from me right now, and you go in your path better. Don't be like endless people out there that they're going to charge for the information that you just guess, right? People do that. They learn something, they don't get credit, and then they go sell it and put in a course. There's so much ways to make money. Like I tell people, you don't even need to work anymore. You can just put your money to make your money.
Yeah.
You know, people, they don't understand that you can $2,000, and if you have an AI bot, trade that $2,000 and double every year, now adding a dollar to it, it becomes $1 million+, right? But again, money is mindset. It's about doing your homework, researching, not being greedy, helping others. When you focus on that, that is magic in it.
Absolutely. And if you thank you for that, man. That's some fantastic advice. That's something I learned, and I'm continue to learn. You never stop learning, but I learned how compound interest takes effect. So, you know, like you said, you take some money, you know what I mean? Not a lot, just a little bit, and you put it here, the trend is your friend. You put a little bit of money here, you see that start growing for you, then you add that, you take profits from there, don't touch the principal, take profits from there, and go to the next one and do the same. You know what I mean? Darren Hardy's The Compound Effect talks about that. So that's another book that you guys can, you know, can download or go read on Audible or whatever the case may be. Great. Thank you, Carlos. I appreciate that. Next question for you. Oh, go ahead. No, go ahead.
Oh, no, I say anytime. I get fired up. Sometimes you
got to
stop me.
No, I love it. I love the passion. I'll just tell my team that you're very passionate. Like, I couldn't have picked a better first guest to be on here because you're going to always bring the passion, the compassion, the fire. And you're just like this normally. It's not like, okay, well, I'm getting up on my mentee's podcast and I'm going to bring the passion here and then the rest of the time I'm down. No. You're like this all day, every day. Like, this is you. This is authentically you. So that's I really appreciate everything that you're bringing to the podcast right now.
Oh, man, I appreciate you. But you know, something funny. I was in LA, right? So tell me how sometimes you're waiting in the line.
Yeah.
You know, and they want to interview you in those red carpets. So as I was waiting in line, I had a group of people around me, and I pulled my phone, and okay, I started showing them some of the AI tools that I play with and some of the tools that I play with to make money. And they like, dude, you're so fired up. And every day, like you say, but the way how you are on camera, off camera, mm-hmm, home, in the street, you know, always be you. Be the unapologetically you.
There you go.
Because if you try to be one person on camera and off camera, eventually it's going to catch up to you.
Yeah.
And then, you know what I mean? It's going to make you depressed. You're going to become like some of these celebrities that they kill themselves because, you know, they could have picked up the phone and they could have called myself. Mm-hmm. They could have called Tony Robbins. They could have called Hammond. They could have called somebody, right? Just give them another perspective. And always be you. If you have something that's helping your business, that's helping you save time, that you don't have to work 40 hours a week, that you can work an hour a day, mm-hmm, and make a lot of money, teach other people. We're not going to take all this money with us.
Yeah.
Right? And then so that now we can challenge one another to go do more philanthropic work, mm-hmm, to go help more kids and learn another language. Like, I speak several languages. I go around the world and I talk to villages and I teach kids. And that's the stuff that I don't put on social media. It's, mm-hmm, between me and God. Mm-hmm. Right? What are you doing right now that's between you and God? How much more money are you donating above and beyond the tax bracket?
Exactly.
I want to make you listen to me right now so much money. The listener, the one that's struggling, I want you to become a multimillionaire. You say after me right now, I am going to become a multimillionaire. Mm. You listening to me right now that's struggling, and you just say, and you touch your heart, and you say, I am going to become a multimillionaire.
Yeah.
I'm going to, like, constantly, when my brain tries to stop me, I'm going to say, nor today, you brain. Dear mother, I'm not listening to you today. You feel me? I am not my feeling. I am a masterpiece because I am a piece of the master. And you know, and you just go there. Because I'm going to make you become a multimillionaire, and you're going to message me on social media one day, and you're going to say, Carlos, I did it. I listened to that show that Jay invited you a long time ago, and now years pass by, and I am a multimillionaire.
What is
next, brother? Challenge me. What is freaking next?
Let's go.
You know what I mean?
Man, you make me want to run through a brick wall, man. I'm feeling like a credible Hulk right now, man. That's what I'm talking about. Yeah. That's what I'm talking about, Carlos. Yeah. Exactly what I'm talking about, man. You're like this all the time, and I love it, man. Thank you for that. Thank you. Man, that's some great fire stuff right there. Next question for you. You've been on stages with some of the greatest motivators and influencers of our generations. People from Les Brown, Jay Shetty, Tony Robbins, etc. Can you let the audience know what that was like and how it made you feel and how it shaped your life to where it is right now? Because a lot of people will never, they might see him from a distance on a podcast, or they might pay for a seminar to go to, and that so-and-so is speaking at, Les Brown is speaking out, or whatever the case may be, and maybe get to shake his hand or whatever, but to be on stages and introduce these guys or be on the stage at the same time when they're on, whatever the case may be, whether they're the headliner or you come on before, whatever the case, doesn't matter. Just how it made you feel mindset-wise, body-wise, emotional, everything, and how it shifted and changed your life to where you are the way you are right now. How did you go from being like that to where you are right now, being on stages with these influencers?
That's a great question. That's a powerful question.
Yeah.
You know, I love those guys, man. And it's, you know, like attracts like, mm-hmm, the universe does, whatever you believe, they are threats to one another, right?
Yeah.
It puts great people like us to get in the same room, in the same stages, in the same arenas around the world. And, you know, they're just like us, right? Like, you know, they love, they are the same way, on mm-hmm. and off camera. They love helping people. They love teaching and educating others how to make money, lifting, like empowering, encouraging. And I remember, Jay, when I was a kid, and my grandpa, well, sometimes he would come home drunk, and I talk about this in my book, and he would abuse mm-hmm. my grandma and I. And sometimes I would push the furniture and my grandma against the wall so my grandpa wouldn't come in.
Yeah.
And then I'll be sleeping on the floor below my grandma in the hammock, and she would say the Les Brown quote in Portuguese. Mm-hmm. Va para a lua, meu filho, que você vai chegar nas estrelas. Mm. Shoot for them, and you will land among the stars.
Wow.
And she constantly said, like, stay hungry. That mm-hmm. is greatness within you.
There you
That's
go.
That's my story, and I'm saying it, right?
Yes.
So she's always this. She, because my grandma was a maid mm-hmm. for a professor. So she would clean professor houses. You know, professors, they would travel to like a big city and they would stay there for the week and then they would go back to their home. So my grandma would clean those houses, those professors that spoke at universities. And when she was cleaning, she always listened to their conversation. They're very mm-hmm. intellectual. She's always saw the books that they read. And she would take some of the books, she would read it on her free time. And she always spoke life into me when I was a kid. And wow. because she knew, you know, she knew my father was very intelligent. And she knew that if I really wanted it, I could have become somebody that could make an impact, right? Mm-hmm. And I used to tell her, so she would tell those quotes of Les Brown. I said, Grandma, why does Les Brown and Tony Robbins and Jim Rome and some of the celebrities that were big back in that time, like Chirp Norris, mm-hmm. why they don't come here and some of the musicians like Michael Jackson and Princess Diana, why they don't come here to the block, to the hood, and they teach us how to become royal, mm-hmm. how to become like Michael Jackson, how to become like Chuck Norris, how to become like Les Brown, mm-hmm. how to become like Tony Robbins. So, and she always tell me, eles não falam português. They don't speak Portuguese. And I said, you know what, Grandma? One day, I'm going to be just like them. I'm going to become their friend. We're going to mentor one another. We're going to challenge one another. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to help. I'm going to challenge for us to raise the bar. Mm-hmm. And I say that, and I get the chills when I think about this story. I told that to Les Brown once, and him and I, we had a tear about it. And, you know, and I told that to Tony too, and then all of the people that have the honor, that my grandma told me about them, you know, when I was a kid. I had an honor to be with Bob Proctor mm-hmm. the last time we were on an online stage, one of the last big stages that we've done it online, and then he passed.
Yeah.
And, you know, but it's funny, and then when I met them, the first thing that I wanted to tell them was that story of my grandma. Mm-hmm. And I told them, thank you for writing the book. Mm-hmm. Thank you for putting the videos on the cassette. Mm-hmm. the good old tapes.
Yeah.
You know, the good old tapes.
He got the cassette. That's how you know you old school. You got the cassette up there. Yeah.
I get emotional when I think about this because We rolled the song. I got the boombox in here in my office, and I thanked them.
Yeah.
Because I think if my grandma wouldn't have the hands on those books, I wouldn't become strive to become. I wanted to become like them.
Yes.
And become as great as them, where we could all collaborate and better ourselves every day, mm-hmm. even if it's just 1%. Because what we have done is powerful, but what is next, right? And when I put myself around them, they were just like the person that I imagined, like, mm-hmm. you know, like that great energy that I had around my grandma, loving, always charismatic, mm-hmm. giving back, helping, putting others first before their needs. And it was incredible being around that energy at the same room. And then, you know, I remember one time, and it was a dream come true. There's a lot of private and underground masterminds around the world that the elite and the influencers they go to. Mm-hmm. And one time, years ago, I was invited to go speak at this mastermind. It's like by invitation only. You cannot buy it. You got to be invited. Mm-hmm. And since COVID, they haven't done it again, but I pray that they will still do it. And a lot of gurus, and they would go and attend that event. And one day, I was invited to speak for them. And I was so happy. I had the tears.
Wow.
Because I remember telling my grandma one day, I said, one day, Grandma, we're going to speak life. Mm-hmm. I'm going to challenge all of us we can do even more. I know we all done great things for humanity, but is there anything else that we can do? Is there anything else, if we were to die today, is there anything else left in the gas tank of any one of my friends and I that are out there inspiring millions of people? Mm-hmm. That's my worst fear, Jay, is knowing that if I would die tomorrow, if I have anything left in the gas tank. Mm-hmm. And that day, I remember me being on the stage, Jay Shetty was over there sitting down front, you know, on a table, mm-hmm. looking at me like, you know, and I was telling my crazy stories, and Liz was there, and a bunch of people were there. And I was like so happy to be telling them the stories and seeing their face, right? Giving them the feelings that they give to others of love and helping people and becoming better. And for me, it was like a dream come true, right? Speaking to my professors, you know what I mean? Like, I always tell people, eventually the student can become the professor.
Teacher. Yeah.
But never forget that we are eternal students. Learn that from Jim Rohn, right?
Yes.
The moment that you think that you are too good or you are this, that's the moment that you lose everything, right? Mm-hmm. You got to constantly be a student and collaborate with your professors and with your mentees, mm-hmm. because I learned just as much from my students than I teach them. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So it was a very incredible feeling. Like, Tony Robbins is next level, man. Like, being on this stage with Tony, I'm Tony's 6'7", I'm 6'5", and I'm a little bit chubbier than Tony.
Both of y'all a couple of giants on the stage, man. That's crazy.
The energy, man. The energy that Tony Robbins, if you guys ever shake his hand or hug him, and you know what I'm talking about, but you feel that when you listen to his tapes and his CDs and his podcast. But being on the stage with that man, it's another level. The energy field, it's always passing love, and it's something incredible, man. Tony and Liz Brown, Jay Shetty, very few people have this energy field and charisma and love that, and it's very, it's pure, it's sincere.
Wow.
You know what I mean? And just it's something else. Nobody ever asked me that question. I love that question, Jay.
No. I mean, the reason why I asked it, because obviously I know you, I've been knowing you for a couple of years now, and if you don't know, I'm gonna let you know, you're like a mentor to me. You're not, you know, we haven't officially became mentor and mentee, but you know, there's still unofficial mentors and mentees too. That's why everything that you do, you always have to look at it from the eyes of someone else watching you. You never know, like, you have kids, your kids are always watching you, you know, people, friends and distant family and things like that, distant friends, family members, they're always watching you. So everything that you do, you got to always do things with good character, integrity, and all that, because you never know who's watching you. And
it's funny to say that. My daughter, I homeschool her, and we travel around the world. Whenever I'm speaking, she's in the backstage, and sometimes she even goes on the stage.
Yeah.
And one time we were speaking at a big mastermind in San Diego for a bunch of gurus and influencers.
Mm-hmm.
And we were at the hotel walking on the highway. And my daughter was, you know, she was telling me, all right, Isabella, what is the three laws and the three of success to become successful?
Okay.
And she was like 5, 6 years old. And now she's telling me the three laws of success, because I always embedded on her those things. And then a few people overheard it. And it was priceless, because this one guy walks to me and he's like, Carlos, I gotta tell you, man, I don't know if you remember me when you went to Ty Lopez's house and you were recording on MentorBox. I was invited by the MentorBox group that they owned that. And I recorded a segment for my book, Work Like an Immigrant.
Yeah.
And it became one of the most listened segments in that platform. And I was very honored, because people like Tony Robbins and Oprah and a bunch of people are there in that platform.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, I heard your daughter have that conversation with you, and I had to come here to you. And now we're on the front of the hotel waiting for the car to take us up. And then Bradley is a few feet from me listening, like looking at this, like, what the heck? And then this guy walks to me because, you know, dude, I heard your 5-year-old telling you the three rules of success, and it was just so beautiful seeing a miniature of you and a kid and a daughter so happy and what she told you. Mm. And I never thought of it, like, wow, he was listening.
Yes.
And then he came to the front, all the way at the hotel, before me get in the driver's, in the car that was going to pick us up. And then Bradley over here, a few feet away, listening and looking at us like, who the heck? You know, and I don't think Brad and I didn't know each other back then.
Yeah.
He's like, who the heck is this dude?
Yeah.
And something that I always tell people, man, you never know who is watching. And I always tell people, it's like, if you are just beginning, and if you're ever speaking in front of a powerful group, never underestimate your story or your struggles, mm-hmm. because the unknown person in the room has the greatest leverage. Mm-hmm. You see, if you are on the stage, let's say if Jay Shetty, Tony Robbins, Liz Brown, and me, we are all speaking on the stage, mm-hmm. and you got to go after us, the pressure is on us.
Yeah.
That been doing this for so many decades.
Yeah.
You have a story and a struggle that nobody knows behind closed walls. Mm-hmm. So I used to do consulting and train people back in the day. I tell them the unknown person in the room has the greatest leverage.
Wow.
Never, ever, ever forget that. You know what I mean? You got to bring them into your story.
Yeah.
And you got to take them there, take them to a place that they haven't been before. And it's magic in that. But you know what I mean? Funny, you bring me all the great memories, my friend. I appreciate
them. Real quick, before we go to the next question, we have a couple more questions before we're done with our time here. Thank you for your time again, brother. I appreciate it. I want to elaborate a little bit on that, because the whole going last and the pressure being on the influencers, you would think that, damn, okay, it's Carlos. Then it's Jay, and then it's Les and Bradley, whoever's there, whatever guru is there. You would think, dang, the pressure is on me, the last person, because these people are already established. They already got followers and things like that. They already got their events, their products, their services. They already are made men and women, whoever's up there. It's funny that you say that, because most people would think it's the other way around compared to the way you put it. But I like the perspective the way you put it, because it is more so, if you really think about it, it's more on the influencers to really produce, because they already have done it. So they have to produce at that level now. They're already at the high level, so they got to stay there compared to...
They're getting paid to be there, right?
Yeah.
They're getting paid to be there.
Exactly.
You got to add value. You know, you got cameras on you.
Yeah.
Whoever is there filming it.
Yeah.
This thing is going to be out there on social media, like no pressure. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Imagine you're talking to a group of Saudis and billionaires in Dubai and Qatar and Monaco. And you're like, oh, shit, what am I going to teach this billionaire?
Yeah.
Like, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
You got to bring your A game. I'm like, okay, I'm going to tell them some stories, and I'm going to give them some perspectives in life, you know, and I'm going to teach them, you know, whatever topic I was hired to talk about. But the person that nobody knows in the room has the greatest they don't know your story.
There you go.
And that is power in a story. And never underestimate or think, oh, Carlos, oh, Jay, you know, like you say, Jay, you were homeless before. Mm-hmm. Oh, I've never been homeless, so I can't explain it. No. Everybody has a story. Yep. I don't care, you know, what it is, you know what I mean? We all have a story.
Yeah.
And if you think that there's somebody right now that are where you were 5 years ago, and you can teach that person whatever you overcome to be where you are now 5-10 years later. And you can teach that. You can lift others. You can go speak in a college about how did you overcome depression, how you just learned something new from here today about how to go make $1,000 a week helping 10 businesses, charging them $100 a week to go write blogs and posts for them, right? Leveraging AI. It's going to be powerful masterpiece posts. Right. So now you can go teach. You can go to a local college, say, hey, Dean, I would love to come over here and speak live to some of your students that I learned from my mentor, Jay, from my mentor, Carlos, from my mentor, whoever. Right. Give that person the credit, you know. And now you go and you teach it, because there are people right now that are where you were 5-10 years ago that wish that somebody would share how they overcame that problem. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
Absolutely. Facts sell. Absolutely. And everything you said is 100% facts, man. And that's exactly how I learned from people like you and other influencers, and even people who are necessarily don't have that status, but show me, hey, this is what you do. This is how you get to the next level. You do what the wealthy do, you'll have what they have. Eventually, you'll have what they have. So a couple more questions for you, my man. Besides being an excellent speaker and motivator, what other businesses do you own, operate, or projects you're currently working on that you can help a lot of people in the financial department that they're struggling in?
I mean, the biggest thing, right? I look for things, I like to make things super simple.
Mm-hmm.
Jay, because a lot of people out there, they teach things or they promote things that only people on the top end up making.
Yeah.
That only the influencers make it, only the wealthy make it. But what happens if you don't know, you don't have a following? What yeah. happens if you are struggling, you don't have anyone, you are just beginning?
Like, which
I just taught
people,
you guys
yeah.
away.
Mm-hmm.
Correct, right? So, which is most people. So, especially after COVID, a lot of people are struggling. So, I just gave you guys a perspective on how to go make $1,000 a week. Even if you help five businesses only, $100 each, that's still $500 a week, $2,000 a month. Let's say if you rent a bedroom, you know, and you pay $500 for the bedroom, another $500 for food and gas.
Mm-hmm.
Now you have $1,000 left for your name. What I would do with the extra $1,000, I will focus on passive income.
Mm-hmm.
Ways to, as I am working, how can I put my money to work for me
mm-hmm.
so I can compress the years, the decades into years, because now you don't have to work as much to generate enough money necessary to pay your bills.
Mm-hmm.
Once you generate enough money to pay your bills on a monthly basis, now you can do more of what you love. You can become more creative. You can focus on become whether you want to become a better speaker, an influencer, a mm-hmm. podcaster, a movie star, a musician, whatever is your hobby, right?
Yes.
So what I always see, I have a lot of projects that I promote. I do affiliate marketing, and I only promote products that are helping people that everybody can win.
Yes.
Whether you have anybody that follows you or you have nobody.
Mm-hmm.
Because if I can teach you that, that's duplicatable,
mm-hmm.
right? Now, I have the military mindset. I did a little bit of Marines in Brazil when I was young, and they threw me out of there because the surgeon called my mother the D-word. But that's another story for another day.
Yeah.
And in the Marines, I have lost a lot of Marine friends in the U.S. as well. I love the military. They around the world, they protect.
Yes.
And we have a term that we call transcendence, and that is above oneself.
Mm-hmm.
And that's that place where it's no longer about him and about me, about you. It's about above all of us.
Mm-hmm.
That's when we become one.
Yeah.
That's unity, right? And from that place, there is no casualty.
Mm-hmm.
From that place, we all come home.
Mm-hmm.
From that place, we all can win out of the same table. So when companies, Fortune 500 or 5,000 companies, or influencers, or whoever, come to me and to help talk about their products or become an affiliate to their product, my biggest thing is that, can this help that struggling kid in the favelas of Rio, or that struggling kid in the streets of Nigeria, or in the streets of India, or in the streets of US or Canada, whatever, mm-hmm. right? So if it can help, it must help every single person, not just the people on the top. And those are the things that I focus on. I've been partnering with a lot of great groups. If you guys follow me on Instagram, at mm-hmm. Carlos Inspire. And if you click on the link under my bio, I always talk about great companies that mm-hmm. I am big on commodities, on silver. I am big mm-hmm. on leveraging AI
mm-hmm.
to go trade the most liquid financial sectors. Let's say, for example, Forex technology. Forex, it trades $5 trillion per day.
Mm-hmm.
Every single day, $5 trillion
is
going to move
in the market.
Mm-hmm. Import, export, and tourism.
Mm-hmm.
So when you use the AI and you put yourself around the best of the best in the planet, these people, they don't lose money,
mm-hmm.
right? So you can take little money, trade in those sectors, and now your money makes you money on a daily basis
mm-hmm.
that you can, you know, like Jay said, you leave your principal there and
yeah.
you just take
the profits.
Percentage.
Exactly.
Correct.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So that's the things that I focus on. I focus on tools that can not only I make us money, if I promote any affiliate tools, whether it's affiliate AI tools or trading tools or commodity tools, I love blockchain, I love Forex, I love AI, mm-hmm. I love, you know, all these sectors, silver, I like, you know, gold. I think silver is going to do better than gold. That's my personal opinion, not
mm-hmm.
not financial advice. So those are the companies that I promote, is the companies that anybody can come in from zero. They can either buy for themselves and make money, mm-hmm. or they can choose, they can, it's optional, they can promote to others. And now we diversify, right? So now you have a couple of thousand in Forex, couple of thousand in AI, in blockchain, in silver, within multiple sectors. Mm-hmm. And over time, your wealth is going to grow, because especially if you tend to focus on sectors that are at the beginning of an economic cycle. So you can do what the Rockefellers are doing, and, mm-hmm. but with a little bit less money. You don't have to have the billions that they have. You can play with hundreds or with thousands, mm-hmm. and little by little, patient is a virtue, it will grow. Because mm-hmm. the money flows from the impatient to the patient.
There you go.
Somebody stolen that from the Bible. I think it was Warren, you know, that stolen that quote from the Bible. But,
wow.
you know.
Wow.
And, so those are the things that I focus on, Jay. Like, I never like to focus just in one company in particular. Mm-hmm. I focus on sectors.
Yes.
And the sectors that I promote right now heavily is leveraging AI to trade Forex and CBDCs, which mm-hmm. is very liquid. It's not so volatile like crypto or mm-hmm. like certain stock sectors, right? Or I'm not messing around real estate either at this moment. As since COVID happened, commercial real estate is collapsing because people are not going back to work in a building. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of empty buildings around the world. Is eventually we're going to have to convert anybody that owns large commercial real estate into properties, into mm-hmm. condominiums and apartments and whatever, hotels, because everything has shifted since yeah. COVID. So once you understand those things, it makes you become a better investor, a better philanthropist, a better venture capitalist, knowing where to put in your money so that you can 5, 10, 100 exit by positioning yourself early on so that you can help more people.
Mm-hmm. The intelligent investor with Benjamin Graham, he talks about that, you know, how to take sectors and know what's going on within the, you know, the economy, and like, hey, is a good time to invest into real estate? No, probably not, because like you said, during COVID, a lot of people aren't trying to go back to a building for whatever reason, whether they believe in it or not. They just not trying to go there. They'd rather be home and work from home. That's why, you know, a lot of the the network marketing and a lot of stuff that you can do from home, you know, remote, people are doing that now. You know what I mean? So
it's growing. It's a new trend. So, you know, commercial, I have a lot yeah. of people that used to invest in commercial real estate. They come to me because they know I have access to, I'm in Silicon Valley for 20 plus years, and I've done consulting for the wealthiest people in the planet.
Yeah.
So they know that if I am playing with something, and you know me how I am, not only I talk about it, I document mm-hmm. the process on social media so other people can see it.
Yeah.
And some of the things that I talk about, sometimes they may be new to some people because society is not exposed to certain things, mm-hmm. why there are things that only the 0.1% and the 1% knows. And it's by design, right? There's a lot of things out there that the system, the banks and the hedge funds and the mm-hmm. insurance companies, they don't want you to know, because if you do understand it, you're going to do what they are
you're
doing.
You're playing on their level.
And not
yeah.
what they are telling.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So, and those are the things that I focus on. That's another, I love that question, brother. So definitely, if you guys want to learn, I'm always, you know, Ed, new things, new affiliate marketing companies that I love, and I always put them on my Instagram, on my TikTok, Carlos Inspire. Follow me there, and you guys know some of the tools that I love the most, whether it's in AI, blockchain, Forex, silver, commodities, or whatever other sectors I am talking about, for the, because everything has trends, and you have to understand on how to get into trends mm-hmm. early on, not after everybody else gets.
Absolutely. Well, I'm glad that was actually my last question. And before we wrap up here, is how can our subscribers reach you in regard? You already named two of them, TikTok and Instagram, but is there any other social media platforms that you are on that you want them to follow you on, an email that you want them to email you? I'm pretty sure you don't want everybody calling you, but you know what I mean?
Normally, you know, I'm big on Instagram and TikTok.
Okay.
I am there, you know, as much as I can. I mean, I have my team also to help me, but I'm very personal.
Yeah.
I mean, yes, I love leveraging AI to do 2 hours work instead of 40 hours. And I've been teaching people how to do that.
Yeah.
And then I share all my tools on social media. So all my, because I wanted to have a place where long after I am dead, there are videos and instructions and the things that I vet personally. And the best places is always Instagram, TikTok, and if those industries, if they ever goes away, you can always email us info@carlosinspire.com. You can go to carlosinspire.com and you're always going to have access to all my links, all the things that I promote, all the things that I talk about. If you guys want me to come and speak for your company or your foundation, I do a lot of work with companies and board of advisory. And, you know, as long as I get some notice, you know, I love the helping people and speaking life into the employees. I work with a lot of Fortune 5,000 companies. So Carlos Inspire, in the singular, CarlosInspire on TikTok, Instagram, and then on LinkedIn by my name, Carlos Siqueira. I'm very focused on LinkedIn. Do a lot of posts there as well. And I love interacting. I love when people reach out to me and they tell me that, oh, I listened to you on this place. I listened to you on MentorBox. Mm-hmm. I listened to you on Jay Show. I listened to you on so-and-so TV show or podcast or radio. Mm-hmm. And I took that one golden nugget that you share, and it saved my life. It saved my marriage, my business. It helped me make a little bit more money that I needed that month to pay for my college tuition, whatever. You know, I love hearing stories from the people that listen to my advice. And again, it's not me, guys. It's a higher force that just comes through me, and I just love helping others.
Well, Carlos, thank you, my brother. Again, I appreciate you for being my very first guest on my show. You gave a lot of nuggets and a lot of just great inspirational things for people to follow and how they can reach you and everything. And man, it's just beautiful. I just love the way God works, man. I'm a big follower of Elohim, Yahweh, Jesus Christ. You know what I mean? I always give his Hebrew name and everything. Without him, none of this is possible. We already know. And to go from where we came from, both of us, but really with your story, to go from where you came from to where you are right now, is truly, truly inspirational. Thank you for joining the Wealth Champs podcast, family man. I really appreciate you. Thank you from the bottom of my heart, brother.
Amen, my friend. It's my pleasure. I'll leave you guys with this quote that my grandma and I always talk about. Life, it's all about the mission. Mm-hmm. Never the commission. Every single thing that we do is about contribution, never acquisition.
Wow.
And whenever you feel a little bit down and you feel depressed, you feel like pulling that trigger or jumping on that bridge, I want you to think about a brother here that's 6'5", 300 plus pounds, looking at you in the eyes, giving you a hug, lifting you out of the floor, and saying, the days that breaks us are truly the day
that makes us. Yeah.
Look.
Wow.
Let's go.
Thank you, Carlos. I appreciate you, man. Thank you so much.
Thank you, brother.
Thank you.
I got to run for a meeting that I'm 5 minutes late, but I love it. And I thank you so much. Appreciate you. Much love, my friend.
Thank you.
Rock and roll.
All right. See you. I'll see you later, my brother. Thank you so much, brother. Appreciate you.
Thank you, my friend. Have a blessed day.
All right. You too. All right, champers. Well, there you got it. There you have it. That was Carlos Siqueira. I'm sorry. I messed up his name again. He's going to kick my butt, but it's okay. You see, he's very passionate. He's very compassionate about people. He loves. His story was phenomenal and amazing. It just really touched my heart to know that where he came from to where he's at right now, anybody, any of us can do that. Any of us. There's no excuse. As long as you're willing to not give up and to keep going and keep trying and keep getting up, doesn't matter. You will get there, okay? Follow us on YouTube, Wealth Champs Podcast, Rumble, Wealth Champs Podcast. You can subscribe to us there, and you can also follow us on Instagram at Wealth_Champs_Podcast, TikTok and Facebook, Wealth Champs Podcast. So with all that being said, thank you for tuning in for the very first episode. We got plenty more episodes coming, a lot of fire guests. We're gonna have some in studio guests that's gonna be coming in. Some of them are gonna be top tier influencers that you guys know and love and follow and like. You might not like them, some of them, it's okay. You know what, at the end of the day, as long as they bring a value to you in some shape, form, or fashion, we're here to deliver it. So with all that being said, thank you to my team, thank you to everybody who supported me, and I can't wait to go on this beautiful journey with you guys. Until then, see you when I see you. Wealth Champs is out. Peace.